Well, I started out down a dirty road. Started out all alone. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing.
Good afternoon, everyone. Hopefully that sunshine and the thought of thoroughbred racing puts a smile on your face wherever you are. I know it certainly does on mine. I'm Acacia Courtney. Happy Friday. Welcome to Gulfstream today. We're so glad to have you watching and supporting Gulfstream Park. And again, it really means a lot to all of us here at the racetrack that are connected with these incredible horses to have everybody watching and wagering from home. We are just now one day out from the Curlin Florida Derby. We have a fantastic 11 race card on tap today. And once again, unfortunately, our doors do remain closed to the public. But just a reminder that you can, of course, stream everything for free on GulfstreamPark.com. Download the First Bet app. You have plenty of statistics, replays available, live odds, all kinds of great things on there. You can watch and wager on the First Bet app or on ExpressBet.com or the Express Bet app. We give you lots of options in order to watch that. And here's a nice little bonus for you here for First Bet. So download the First Bet app and take advantage of all of that good stuff. So again, lots of good things today. And that does include maybe not so good for me, but Beat the Expert is coming up today. I'm handling simulcast land today, so that means I will be up for Beat the Expert. You can go to our Facebook page or go to the Beat the Expert tab on the Gulfstream Park website. Enter your picks for the 11 race card. You can find all my selections on the website for my top picks, and if you pick more winners than me, you have the chance to win one of those Beat the Expert polos. So please let us know that you're playing. I've had a bunch of people tweet me already. And again, we really love it. It's a lot of fun. And there's nothing we love more on Beat the Expert Day than short price favorite, which is how I'm hopefully kicking off the card. But again, it's a nice wager. One of the wagers today we do offer. But let's check out the entire wagering menu. $2.1 million. Is the guarantee in today's Rainbow Six. It starts in race six on this 11 race card. We have a couple of pick fours, couple of pick fives, super high five with any race with seven or more runners. And that does start off in race number one with this nice big field of 12 for this maiden special weight. It does also kick off today's early pick five and a 7-5 favorite in Counter Strike. Maybe that's going to be a good omen for Beat the Expert today as we take a look at my ticket here. I'm going three deep, though. I like a couple of other horses in this field, potentially. Give Me Some Mo, I think, is really going to like getting onto the turf. And Turn of Events, for what it's worth, is coming out of graded stakes competition. Two deep in race number two, three horses in the third, which is a maiden 50. I think Bourbon Street, second off the claim and second time as a gelding, is going to take a step forward today as he really improved last time. I like the fourth race quite a bit. That's a maiden special weight going five on the turf for the fillies. I think that's a really interesting race as well. And then I'm just going to single just to keep things a little bit more affordable. Stormy Boss on the drop and has some speed. Just looks like the one to beat to me on the outside in that tricky field. So maybe you have some stronger opinions. Maybe a single horse like Counter Strike and you can spread a little bit more in that fifth race. But I did think that that horse in this sequence could be my anchor in here. So a $27 play, and mentioned Counter-Strike a couple of times, and that's where we'll start in this mile and 16th race, maiden special weight for the three-year-olds. This is a colt by Street Boss, who ran a really, really good race for Brendan Walsh in his debut, and we'll show you that. This was on February 2nd. Now, I had noted that this horse looked really well prepared, was a touch studdish, a little bit keyed up in the saddling area prior to the race, but once they got the tack on, really settled nicely. Fancy Liquor, an impressive first-time starter. We did have a spill there. Jock and horse were A-OK, so no need to worry about that. But the top two finishers not impeded there. A little bit of bumping in the stretch. Horse is still a little bit green, but a first-time starter in Fancy Liquor for Mike Maker, who really did show that he was ready to roll and debut. I thought it was an encouraging effort from Counter-Strike. Ian Wilkes as well. First-time starters not necessarily the highest percentage that you will see from this barn. Third-place finisher Proven Strategies did come back to win nicely in the next start. I alluded to Gimme Some Mo. I had noted physically last time out that I thought he might like the turf, and that's kind of what I've been thinking about him in his first couple of starts. So he's 7-1 right now. This is one that I could see maybe putting a little bit of a bet on just because I thought he could like the grass. He has a sibling that won 2 times on the turf by Uncle Mo. He was very keyed up, studdish, vocal in his debut, and he's gotten progressively more mature, which is something I like to see. Mentioned turn of events for Mike Maker. Comes out of the Grade 3 Palm Beach, ran in that race, is still a maiden, broke on top, but then had a long shot go and set the pace. So this horse today, especially with blinkers on, he's going to be part of the speed early on. Race number 2, we'll turn the page now, going to the main track, 6 furlongs, $12,500 claiming race for the 3-year-old fillies, and the number 1, Ms. Chaplin. Though she hasn't raced in a while, we haven't seen her since the start of November at Gulfstream Park West. Boy, she looks like the one to beat. This could potentially be a race where maybe you just kind of press on her. But she was the heavy favorite that day, dropping in for $20,000. She won by 6 lengths. She was claimed by Safi Joseph Jr. for $20,000. We haven't seen her since. And now she comes in for the $10,500 tag. So it is a drop, but she is off the layoff. She's been training really sharply as well at Gulfstream Park West, and she has some speed. Louis Saez aboard just kind of looks like the type of horse that we'll get to the winner's circle there for Safi. The number 7, Don't Get Cozy, meanwhile, dropped to this level last time out. Ran a good second under Tyler Gaffleone. Race number 3 now, maiden claiming $50,000 for the 3-year-old, 6 furlongs on the main track. And I had alluded to the number 1, Bourbon Street, when talking about my pick 5 ticket. I was curious about this one because he was claimed 2 starts back. And I had actually thought, being by Curlin and looking at him physically, he might appreciate more distance than the 6 furlongs he had turned back to last time. I will say he ran very well. I was a touch surprised to see him as the favorite. I thought Cigar Box was the one to beat in that field. But one thing I think is also really notable is that in between his last 2 starts, he was gelded. And this had been a horse that was a bit of a handful, very studdish in his debut, acting up a little bit prior to the races. And I saw a big change in him mentally after being gelded. And sometimes that's just a major change that does help horses take a step forward. So I think he's in the right spot in here. I still might like to see him stretch out a bit. But last time out was a really big step in the right direction. So I think that that's absolutely a race that he can build off of. And again, that gelding in between those last 2 races, I think, was pretty key for him. To the outside, the number 1, Grand Champagne. Second time out for Victor Barboza. Just a very solid race in that first start. And then Ralph Nix with another first-time starter by Kozan Kataf here for Al Shakab Racing. Edgar Zayas aboard. Some solid works over the main track here at Gulfstream. Maybe a firster might be in the right spot there. We keep with the maidens. Maiden special weight on the turf now. 5 furlongs for fillies and mares, 3-year-olds and upward here in the 4th race. We'll start with the number 4, First Wave. And did find a stat for trainer Rusty Arnold. In the past 5 years, going from dirt to turf in maiden special weights when sprinting. Not a huge sample size, but some pretty impressive numbers. 25% win, 42% in the money. I thought that this was really key, and a big ROI as well. Some of those horses were some pretty big prices. Now, I don't know if this filly by Warfront's going to be much of a price at all, but I did think that if you go off of her lone turf sprint race at Saratoga back in July, she ran a really, really good race and was in fact the favorite that day behind Peaceful, who I think was very talented around that time. And she actually ran a sneaky good race in that tough mile and a 16th turf race at Saratoga too. But I thought that her sprint race was impressive. She was forwardly placed that day. For what it's worth, the race that she does come out of at Keeneland produced a couple of next out winners. Dirt is not the name of her game. She keeps keeps Tyler Gaffalione aboard and has been training on the Palmetto's turf course. To the outside, the number 9, Noble Alma. And she looked to me like she would benefit from a race as far as fitness does go. Smack was the big favorite and the one to beat that day, but now second off the layoff, this filly by Lemon Drop Kid, who stuck with the turf, certainly could move forward. And the number 3, Gloriously, she is the one that really intrigues me in here. She'll likely be maybe a touch of a price compared to the others I mentioned for Jimmy Jerkins. Monster field that she faced in her last race, though it was in August at Saratoga, ran behind Sharing, who came back to win a stake and then went on to win the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies Turf. Now, she, I had noted in my notes from Saratoga that she wanted a little bit more distance and that she would actually fare well on the turf. The interesting thing about that race is, yes, it was a race taken off the turf, but she was entered as a main track only. Because of that, with the race coming off the turf, the race went from 1 1/16 on the grass to 7/8 on the main. So curious as to what we're going to get from her, this 5 on the grass, if she's kind of maybe developed or maybe some of the other horses of her age have caught up to her. Maybe the 5 will be good, but maybe it will just be kind of a stepping stone for her moving forward off the layoff. But I'm very interested to see Glorious again off the bench. We'll go now to race number 5, 6 furlongs on the main track, 6250 non-winners of 2 and Life, 4 fillies and mares, 4-year-olds and upward. And this is the race that I just kind of laid my hat on, the number 7, Stormy Boss. I'm taking a drop in class, had a poor race last time out, but the race 2 and even 3 back were very good. Now, I'm a little bit concerned about her, but I really just think that she's a big standout in this field. Blinkers come off, and again, the drop should be pretty key. The number 6, also taking a drop, or looking for more, or turning back in distance, has been running at this level. Turning back in distance, we'll see how she fares sprinting, as her last couple of races were going a touch longer. We'll go next to race number 6, but first we're going to take a little bit of a break. 11 races today, so the Rainbow 6 starts in the 6th race, so don't go away. When we come back, we'll have that and a whole lot more. Welcome back to Gulfstream Today. Acacia Courtney, very glad to have you joining us virtually here at Gulfstream Park. We're getting ready to check out today's Rainbow 6 sequence. But first, tomorrow, very big day in racing. It's the Curlin Florida Derby, and we have a full field of 12 with one also eligible Rogue Element. Now, do note, Soros is entered in a little bit later today in what Aaron Wellman from Eclipse Thoroughbreds called the Florida Derby Junior, which I think is pretty interesting. Very competitive race coming up later on today's card. If he ends up running, he obviously will scratch out of that Florida Derby field, but we'll keep you updated on that. Again, there is an also eligible Rogue Element for Dale Romans on the outside, so no matter what, we're going to have a full field. But a fantastic rendition. We have Holy Bull winner Tis the Law, Fountain of Youth winner Ete Indienne, and then some really highly touted horses like Independence Hall and Gouverneur Morris. We'll see what we get from all of those. That is part of a 14-race card on Saturday, March 28th, and we have some big guarantees as well. Late Pick 5 and Late Pick 4, 400,000 and 500,000. Yes, that's right. They start in races 10 and 11. And it's a mandatory payout of the Rainbow 6. There is already about 1.5 million in the pool just today. It's estimated the pool will be upwards of $5 million, but everything must go with the Rainbow 6. So make sure you get your handicapping hats on. It is a fantastic card from start to finish. So we hope that you'll be watching and wagering. Don't forget, you can bet everything on the First Bet app and on expressbet.com. But matter of business first is today's Rainbow Six. So we'll show you my ticket. A little bit of a different type of ticket together. I went four deep in this maiden special weight in the first leg. I like this race quite a bit. I have a single with Chase Runner, who I just think is the speed of the speed, going to be perhaps the controlling speed in race number seven, as I wanted two horses in the eighth, and race nine was that race I was alluding to that had been called Florida Derby Junior. It's a mile allowance optional claiming that is just absolutely stacked. Super competitive race, and I went five deep. You've got a couple from Todd Pletcher. You have Our Nation on Parade stretching out. Edge of Fire, who got a lot of people talking in his debut. Really looking forward to that race today. Races 9 and 11 are the box office stars for me today. Two deep in the 10th, and then I wanted four in that nightcap, that allowance on the turf. That's really salty as well. So a little bit more expensive, a $64 play for me, but it's $2.1 million in that Rainbow Six pool. And we do start things off going a mile on the turf in race 6, maiden special weight for four-year-olds and upward. I did start with the number 9, Flame Zapper, for trainer Mark Cassie, and we'll show you his last race because it was actually a very, very game performance from this colt by Go Zapper coming in off of the layoff. Now, there he is stalking. You also have Propensity, who's the number 1 in there. He's in this field as well, but main thing I wanted to highlight was that Propensity was showing speed getting on the turf for the first time for Bill Mott. I wanted to highlight Flame Zapper because here, right here, he has really no place to go. Big move by Tyler Gaffalione to get him inside along the rail. He looks like he just never really has an opportunity, and he really, really is so game, so tenacious. Propensity held on well in between, but I thought that Flame Zapper really ran just a relentless run for not having run in about 8 months. It was a big performance from him, and I thought he could have gained perhaps a little bit more muscle. Having that race last time from a fitness standpoint, he certainly should be able to take a step forward. Second off the layoff with turf running maiden special weight horses in the money last time out. Mark Cassie's 37% winning and 71% in the money. Mentioned the 10 Propensity already. He's got the speed. And the 1 Felix the Fox, second off the bench for Shug McGahey. Has only 1 turf race so far. That was in July in Belmont, going a mile and a quarter. So switching back to the grass today. And then you've got the ever-consistent Rochambeau for Cherie DeVoe, who comes out of a very salty race last time out. We'll go next to race number 7. And this does kick off today's late pick 5. Again, wanting to spread in that 9th race. So it's a different type of ticket than I normally put together. I ended up with 2 singles. I've got the Speedy Chase Runner, so I really need this horse to win today. And then I'm just going to see and alone with the number 3 Frenchman Street in race number 8, even though I really do think Camp Randall is talented. But Frenchman Street has been in fantastic form, and now first off the claim for Mike Maker. Again, spreading with 5 in the 9th race, 2 deep in the 10th, and spreading with 4 in the nightcap for a $24 play. So those 2 singles allow you to have some more coverage in some of the other races. So that's the tactic that I took. But here, I've mentioned this horse a couple times in race number 7. We're going a mile on the main track, 12-5 claiming race for 4-year-olds and upward. Chase Runner looks like the controlling speed. I thought the win 2 starts back was really impressive. Gets back to a mile today. The number 7, Candy Crushem, does have Luis Saez aboard, though will be kind of running later a bit. So hopefully Chase Runner can just dictate the pace. We'll go next to race number 8. Talking about Frenchman Street, he's won 3 of his last 4, and he's only ever won the Manek, but he's done it very, very well. His only race he was beat 2 starts back was behind Karatari, really quality horse who's run against some very tough competition after that now for trainer Brian Lynch. Camp Randall, he came off of the layoff and switched to sprinting on the turf, and that's just been the best move for this colt by Shackelford. Last 2 races were very impressive, and he'll get even another little test today. I did also think Maniacal, who was curiously a reclaim for trainer Eddie Keneally. He had this horse with the same owners back in July of 2018, then back in August of 2019. A year later, he reclaimed him. Always a little bit interesting to see that. He gets back on the grass as well. We'll go now to race number 9. Again, Ray's been talking about, pretty excited about this one. Let's start with the number one, Money Moves, because we do have a replay for him. He's got the inside post, and that's why I wanted to show this replay. Yes, it was raining that day. It was a sloppy track. There he is, the number three. He's already spotting the field. He did not break well. Now, stretching out to a mile and the inside post, it's going to be imperative for him to break well. As we go to the quarter pole, he ends up having to swing wide. It looked like Sagamore Mischief was really in a good spot. I thought that Money Moves, he really had a very long, sustained run. It was impressive. Once he switched leads, he ended up just kind of powering by Sagamore Mischief, who had it much easier on the front end there. But again, having the inside post, now going a mile, it's going to be key that he does break well. And I had noted he was a big type of horse. He didn't necessarily look like the type that would love a wet track. I think he just really showed his quality that day. It was going to be a bigger test for him today. He's one of two in here for Todd Pletcher, who also has Silver Ratio. When I used five, I ended up spreading to include that one as well. We'll see if he can redeem himself after a beat last time out. He has Joel Rosario aboard today. And I'm going to take a shot. I think that there are a couple of horses that could potentially be a bit of a price and have some kind of untapped ability so far, and that's the number two, Edge of Fire. He was a fantastic performance in his debut and got a lot of people talking that day. He's by Curlin. He's out of a grade three placed mare who won going long on the dirt. I don't think he really wanted to be going six furlongs, and he still did it nicely. So I think he's going to really love getting some added real estate today. Second time out for Jimmy Jerkins. Tyler Gaffalione going to be aboard today, and we'll see what he's made of. The number four, Our Nation on Parade, also stretching out. He's one that came off of a layoff last time, ran in the Hutchison, and actually ran very, very well, beaten just half a length. And speaking the connections afterwards, owner Dean Reeves saying he got what he needed out of that six furlong race, and now they do want to get some more ground going a mile. We'll see what he gets. And the number one, Sprawl. I didn't like him trying the turf last time, or the number eight, excuse me. Didn't like him trying the turf last time. So he goes back to the main track where he's run before and he's run well. He's going to be running late, so we'll see what we get from him. But John Velasquez stays aboard and has been training well at Payson Park for trainer Bill Mott. We'll go now to race number 10. We'll kick off today's late double with this race going a mile and an eighth on the turf. The number five, Bacchanalia, for Chad Brown, has been in great form, won his last two, going a mile and an eighth and a mile and a sixteenth, mile and three sixteenths for this filly by Union Regs. One thing we know about her, distance is absolutely no problem. The number nine, Silver Kitten, this one's the main speed. So if she gets comfortable on the front end and Bacchanalia's stuck too far back, Silver Kitten's going to be the one leading the way and showing a lot of speed. And she's been in good form, coming out of a good second behind Get Mother a Rose in the grade three Honey Fox. She may be the one to beat. I did prefer Chad's filly just in her running style and the distance. But again, nothing against Silver Kitten and her tactical ability, who held on really well, showing that speed last time out. We'll wrap things up with race 11, a great race on the turf, an allowance optional claiming. And one thing that's going to need to happen for the horse that I like in Gufo is that he's going to need some pace in front of him. Ask for Bodie, the number five, was really impressive to win first time out for Eddie Keneally. I thought he ran a huge race. He won by four lengths at a little bit of a price as well. He looks like he's one that'll kind of grow into himself as well. Nine furlongs today shouldn't be a problem. But that was only his first race. We'll see if he shows the same kind of speed that he did that day. Montana Man has a little bit of pace, and the number nine, Unconquered Lee, who I absolutely loved getting on the turf last time, he has quite a bit of speed as well. So he's probably going to be the main pace setter in here. If nobody ends up going with Unconquered Lee or Ask for Bodie, just not as quick as him early, we could see a scenario where Unconquered Lee just dictates the pace and runs away from the rest of the field. Big performance from him, and he does pick up Luis Saez. The number two, Gufo, his debut race, you put a line through that, it was a very eventful race. Tough for him to kind of get in and save any sort of ground. There was another horse that had actually hit the rail in the stretch. Again, everybody was okay, but there was a lot of commotion last time, that big sustained run in a race that has produced a couple of next out winners and been very productive as well. And finally, have to mention the number seven, Mystic Lancelot, getting back on the turf before trainer Todd Pletcher had been facing all stakes company before trying the dirt last time, and I had asked Todd about it, and he said he'd kind of tailed off on the turf. So back on the grass today, curious as to what we're going to get from him, but a very interesting race to wrap things up on a fantastic card on Friday. Again, we're very glad to have you with us. Don't forget, you can wager on everything on expressbet.com and on the First Bet app, and I'll be with you throughout the whole day for all of the great racing here at Gulfstream Park. Pete Aiello coming up next with Scratches and Changes.